do you have a 10-gallon tank and you don't know what to do with it yet? Well, I've got some stocking ideas, so stay tuned. The dwarf rainbow tank. It was about time I brought up some of the rainbows because they're super cool. They're a little expensive, but they've got almost like little pom-poms for fins. They're just always waving at you. And so you want to look up pseudomogils. And some of the cool ones are going to be like the pseudomogil luminatus or luminatus, which is the red one, or the neon blue red eye or neon blue eyed red one. There's the fricatas, which are kind of yellow. They've got these pom-poms going on. There's the celebes. They get a little bit bigger, maybe not the best for the 10, but you get a group of maybe three of them. You could go four or five, but you would definitely want one male to more females. Definitely want to plant a tank here. Just because the way they breed, they lay their eggs, they're going to kind of scatter them in the plants, and you need that cover because the male is going to constantly harass the females. That's why they're always kind of doing this move, like, look at me, they're super flashy, and they want the females to look at them, and we get to look at them, and that makes them super cool. They like kind of hard water, you know, and you can go as low as maybe 7.0 pH up to 8.0 pH. They'll probably only breed down at the, you know, like 7 to 7.5, maybe 7.7, minerals, maybe 150 to 200 parts per million. A little bit hard, you know, you don't want to go too soft. But you can always play with those parameters, and keeping them really happy would let you breed them. They'll live in a very wide set of parameters, but they're not that long-lived of a fish, maybe 2-3 years if you're lucky. And, you know, so you want to plan a tank. You want to put some corydoras down below because any food that gets by them, they're not going to eat. So you might use something like panda corydoras or maybe coolie loaches or pygmy corys, hasbrosis corys, something like that, scooting around the bottom. Maybe you got four coolie loaches. Maybe you got six habrosis corys or whatever you want to do down there. Fill it in with plants and enjoy. You know, pick a color that you like. If you get yellow, maybe you want some red plants and some green plants. If you got the red ones, don't pick too many red plants because they'll, you know, it won't look as good. You want that stark red against that green. You can mix them with some tetras, but you lose some of that magic, you know, because they're going to take that top two thirds and really be kind of displaying and doing their thing. You know, you might lose it with, oh, I put in a tetra and now it just, they just hang out, you know. So I do like them as kind of a species tank when it comes to that top two thirds. So think about that and go see someone at a pet store. That's pictures look okay, but when you see them dancing for the females and doing their thing, that's where it really looks cool. Also, you can check out the Werneri or the threadfin rainbow, but they do a little bit better in like a 20 long. You can squeeze them into that 10 gallon if it's just a trio. But you know, when it comes to feeding, a little bit of flake food if you're diligent about it and let them eat it, you know, before it falls too much to the ground, or frozen or live foods. Either one of any of those would work really well. And, you know, hopefully you get a new flavor in your 10 gallon and you get back to enjoying it, or it's your first 10 gallon and you get to learn a whole lot about fish. This one is the Apisto breeder tank. So you want sick lids and you've only got a 10 gallon tank. What do? You get some Apistogrammas. Now, there's a bunch of different types. The easiest ones usually to start with are going to be things like Apistogramma cacatoides, and there's different color variants. There's the oranges, there's the super reds. You can go with Apisto agazizii, and there's that. Then there's double reds. Then there's flame reds. Like, there's always going to be color variants. You could go with Apistogramma trifasciata, blah, 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 blah. There's a bunch of Apistos, but what you want to do is you want to get a pair, a boy and a girl. You want to set them up a sweet, sweet cave. It could be made out of terracotta, could be a cool piece of wood, could be a coconut hut with a hole cut in it. There's all kinds of things, but get them a sweet cave where basically the male can barely fit through and the female can kind of plug that hole, because once they go in and breed, she's going to keep the male out, raise those babies up, and you can watch them, lead them around the tank. I like to do a bunch of live plants because otherwise you kind of got a sterile looking tank, and the live plants are a great place for the babies. Once they kind of hatch and mom and pop aren't watching them anymore, they go back into the weeds and then they go have another batch. And so you can be raising up multiple batches of fry in there, which is really fun. Now, you can use plastic plants, but it kind of always looks the same and you get a bunch of algae growing. If you use live plants, I find that you get all this little infusoria, which is a lot of little bugs and stuff like that for the frying, growing on everything that they can go and pick at and eat. So pH-wise, I would say lower end spectrum, like 7.2 all the way down to 6.5. Temperature, Apistos really like it warm. 82 to 84 is what we recommend. And then as far as foods go, don't feed anything too fatty. Maybe frozen bloodworms once a week. Maybe frozen brine shrimp a few times a week. But a good quality pellet or flake food, that kind of stuff. Like, you want food to keep going through them. It's really easy to get them bloated with too many bloodworms. And we're trying to breed them, so we're trying to get them in condition. But fish foods are so good nowadays, almost any fish food will work. Get them eating well, get them pooping well, and then they'll make babies well. I call this one the guppy tank. So you probably have seen a guppy before, or at least you've heard of it. They're going to have usually big tails, a lot of color. They breed a lot. That's probably the fear you have. Males and females, they get together and they give live birth. So that's kind of a, whoa, scary thing. But it's easy to manage. They'll kind of eat their own young if there's too many. And if you keep the tank sparse, so there's not a lot of decoration, then there's not a lot of hiding spots. But to set it up, I would use crushed coral or already have really hard water. So hopefully you've tested your water and you know, like, oh, I have a pH of 8 and I have a lot of minerals in the water. That would be great for these guppies. If you already have soft water like I do, put a bunch of crushed coral in, wait a week or two, let that crushed coral dissolve into the water. That's going to raise your pH and add some minerals there. From there, you could add a little bit more minerals if you needed to. Then you want to add somewhere between a trio, which would be one male and two girls, and you could let them breed, or you could go with as many as 10 fish. If you're new to fish keeping, I would say start very few and kind of cycle your tank and that stuff conservatively. They really appreciate lots of cover and especially live plants. So if you're going to do fake plants, get a bunch of plants in there so the babies can hide out from the parents and you can raise up some extras. If you're going to do live plants, you can do things like guppy grass, anubias, java moss. All those are great, great ones. Water lettuce, which is a floating plant that puts roots down, that's a good one as well. You're going to need a dedicated light to grow plants, and you're going to need fertilizers, but that kind of comes with the territory. And if you're not at that point yet, usually most people progress. If you're keeping kind of community fish or things that will allow plants to live, most times you will progress to a point where you want that because you understand the benefits, and that is it makes you do less water changes, less maintenance on the tank because the plants are consuming it. It adds an ever-changing landscape in there, which is nice. You can get some cool colors going on. And in general, if you start making a lot of guppies, you might be giving them back to your pet store, giving them to friends, or maybe you're trading them in for some credit. You could be doing that with the plants too. So it kind of helps you transition maybe into that next tank. It's also great for children if you want to kind of teach them about either A, having a little bit of a side job going, or B, how things kind of replicate and we need a responsibility of taking care of it. If we don't take care of it, don't feed small foods, then we don't get babies, that type of thing. As far as food goes, almost anything. A good starter one is a quality flake food. You can do frozen foods. You can do micro pellets, fancy guppy food, all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of food. They'll eat almost anything. And you don't really have to put much on the bottom in terms of a cleaning fish. So you could, but guppies will go eat from all levels of the tank. They'll hang out up top. They'll hang out up middle. They'll hang out at the bottom. You could add a few snails for some algae control. You could also add a plecostomus. Now, you don't want to add like a common plecostomus. You don't want anything that's going to get big, so we've only got a 10-gallon tank. You want to look at things like a clown plecostomus. They eat some wood. They need some wood in there. They eat some meat, so they need some fish food. But they also will snack on the algae too. So consider maybe a clown pleco. Not the easiest thing to get a hold of. Might have to go to a dedicated mom-and-pop type fish store. But snails are pretty easy to find. And plants will also help battle algae. So maybe you don't even need something to eat algae. So one of my absolute favorite tanks. Everyone in their life should have a guppy tank at some point. And that way you can say you've done it and you might never stop doing it. Hopefully you enjoyed the list of stocking ideas for 10-gallon. If you have a stocking list for your 10-gallon right now, leave it in the comments section below. We'd love to get more ideas, and everyone obviously that's watching this video is looking for more ideas, so they can go down in the comments, they can say what they're keeping, and they can see what other people are keeping, and they can know what they plan for the next one, or maybe they're bored of their tank right now. Help us out, we'll crowdsource this thing, and we'll see you in the next video.